Scott Ian.
How's it going?
What's going on, man?
Where do you want me?
Right there in the middle. Welcome to the show. Thanks for swinging by. This is Dan Soder.
Hey, what's up, man?
How's it going?
How are you? Nice to meet
you. How are you?
Good.
Congrats on the new book and everything. Do you like when the first book sells, is that the idea to be like, holy shit, people liked this book. I got to come up with some more stories and do this again.
Well, when the first book sells, it opens the door for you to get a second book.
Right.
So then it's even like, what can I write to get to have a second book?
But that's all. Yeah, you're like, can I do a coffee table book?
Yeah, instantly thinking like, I need another idea here. They're like asking me, do you have any other ideas?
Oh, they come to you at that point.
Well, it was kind of like a combination of. I knew I had stories,
yeah,
and not necessarily that they were left over from the autobiography. There was one story, like I tell the tale of when I played poker professionally for like almost 5 years, and I didn't put it in the autobiography because it was too much of a tangent. It was like this left turn, and all of a sudden it's going to be 70 pages of
right.
Poker. Yeah, because you can't just casually bring up the fact that you were a professional poker player for 5 years.
Right.
You're like, and then I just did this stint as a poker player. But, anyways, high school was rough.
And it wasn't going to fit into the flow of that. So
right,
like,
all the people buying the book are like, what are you talking? I'm not here to read about poker.
Right.
Like,
we're
in this story.
I knew I had that story, and I had this story about Madonna, and I had one or two other stories that I had been telling in these live shows I do where I just go tell stories, basically. So I said, maybe I could do a book of stories. I know I could probably come up with at least 20 really good stories, and that's kind of how the whole thing came together.
So how do you guys who live a lifestyle like yours, I always, like, it boggles my mind when you guys remember everything. You know what I mean? Because you would think that a lot of that would escape you. Do you – as you're going through what you're going through, and Anthrax is becoming super famous, and like all these stories start to happen to you, are you documenting as you go because you know that at one point you're going to want to tell these stories? Or
I have a lackey who's been with me. He's my lackey.
Uh-huh.
I have a lackey who's been with me for about 25 years now, and he writes down everything.
Wait, really? You're like, write this down.
Imagine,
write this down.
I've got this, yeah.
A Burger King employee was rude to me on a day I had the flu.
Yeah,
I think this could be a story.
Did you catch that moment right there?
I'm sorry. Say it again for my friend. He's going to be recording this conversation.
That was important. Yeah. I also just love the idea that a person would be like, no, I'm a lackey,
yeah,
and I like my place in life, and I've been doing it for 25
years.
That's it.
I'm gonna
stay there.
He's a very well-paid lackey.
Are they gonna let Scott keep pulling you around? He's like, I gotta write down the stories.
Yeah, and he's paying me $20,000 a year. So I mean,
you live on that. He's
like, hey, look, there's like, you know, energy bars in the dressing room. He can eat.
You little scavenger.
Yeah, he can sleep on the bus even when it's parked and you're not on tour. Like,
yeah, he sleeps when we perform.
He's just in the bay with the bags underneath. We set up a little like pallet with straw and
it's, yeah, it's like the episode of Seinfeld where Kramer has the businessman in the dresser.
In the drawers.
Yeah, but did you? Yeah, did you?
I remember shit.
You just remember shit.
Yeah, I never drank in the 80s. So the formative years of the band, like if you really want to go back, on my 18th birthday, I got so drunk because it's like, woohoo, I'm legal to drink because I'm that old. That was the drinking age back then.
That's crazy.
And so I turned 18, not that I hadn't been drinking before that, but I got drank so much crappy vodka on my 18th birthday, I had alcohol poisoning. And then I basically didn't drink again. For years.
What kind of vodka? Was it Pop-Off?
It was Pop-Off.
That's the old clean silverware in a restaurant vodka.
It looked cool when you're 18. Oh, it must be Russian.
Yeah, mine's is Barton's.
Barton's
is another discount vodka.
Wow.
It's charcoal. There's something with charcoal in it. And I was like, well, this sounds like
gross.
It's worth $3.99 for a 175.
The price is right.
Yeah.
So I didn't drink in the 80s, all the formative years of the band, and then even when we started to blow up in the mid and late 80s. I wasn't straight edge by any means, but I chose not to drink because the smell of it turned my stomach for so long.
Yeah.
So it wasn't until the 90s that I even started, like, slowly, beer and wine. I'd be really good at nursing a couple of beers. But then early 90s into the mid-90s, I actually started drinking, and it was like, wow, this is really fun.
Well, yeah, did you, when you start getting all fucked up in the 90s, are you like, there were so many years. I could have been fucked up for that. That would have been great.
No, I never looked at it that way because if I would have gotten fucked up in those years, I wouldn't have been able to get fucked up in the 90s.
Right.
Because then maybe the band doesn't happen and I'm not able to just have a lifestyle where I could go get fucked up and hang out with ridiculous people like I do in my book and not have to get up in the morning.
Yeah. Now in the 90s, you got something to celebrate.
Yeah.
Yes,
right?
Exactly.
Right.
I didn't, all those years I worked, I was able to then in the 90s, I'm like, all right, the times are a little shitty for metal in the 90s. I'm just going to go get fucked up.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what happened for 10 years.
It's funny that Scott's like, yeah, I started, you know, really drinking hard in the 90s. And I'm like, yeah, so did I. But I was 15. That's a problem. Mine was not as cool. Mine's like, good. I got school in the morning.
But even through all of that, I do have a really kind of amazing steel trap of a memory for stuff. There was only one story in the book, the one that's called The Wrath of Kirk, where myself and some of the other guys in Anthrax and some of the other members of Metallica, really late night in San Francisco one night after an Anthrax show, we had gone out and the strip clubs and the whole thing, and it's now 2:30 in the morning and we're all pretty tanked and we were looking for a way to play music and realized, well, Kirk lives in the city. He had already left. He had some personal issues to deal with at home.
Mm-hmm.
So we make the adult decision to break into his house.
Oh.
Without telling him,
if he's got personal issues, he probably wants company late at night.
And we decide, well, because Mark's here, Mark from this band called Death Angel, and Mark knows where he keeps the key. And we're going to break into his house and go into his studio downstairs and jam. That seemed like a really good idea.
That's a can't-lose situation.
Yeah, 3 a.m. jamming, drunken Black Sabbath in Kirk's basement, and he was not thrilled.
He wasn't psyched by it?
No. I had known him for 10 years already at that point and had never seen him angry once. Kirk is easily the most kickback dude you'd ever meet in your life, and it all changed that evening.
What does he do? Start screaming? Does he start swinging?
God.
Like
no swinging, but it was more like the angry and then disappointed dad.
Oh, that's the worst because you let him down.
Yeah, and
he
was like one of my best friends, and then he's just like, I can't believe you would do this. And I'm like, oh, my God.
Because you know what it is? You got that drunk energy where at 3 in the morning you go, who wouldn't want to see me?
Right.
We're all so much fun right now.
Yeah,
let's go to his house. He just needs to wake up and realize we're fun.
Who doesn't want 8 of us in his basement playing super loud in his basement?
Kirk Hammons is sleeping, and he's like, is that War Pigs?
Yeah. The story goes on, and there is a happy – there's way more to it. And there is a happy ending. There's a very expensive glass door gets broken later in the story, and that added to the misery. And that story, there were a lot of little details as I was trying to put that one back together. That for some reason I was like, well, who remembered how to get into the house and this and that? And I actually a lot of texting back and forth. That's why at the end of the book, I thank a bunch of people for helping me with some of the when, where, and why of some of these tales.
Because
there were little details that I'm like, who did this and who did that? And between 5 or 6 of us, we were able to put it together.
I was reading the Dave Mustaine story last night, and it made me, like, for now, whenever I think about Dave Mustaine, I think about the Metallica documentary that they did.
Uh-huh.
And, like, him talking about still, to that day, that was, like, the mid-2000s or whatever.
Are you talking about Some Kind of Monster?
Yes.
Yeah.
When he was talking about how he was struggling with the fact that he got thrown out of Metallica or whatever.
Right.
Even though, like, his band is, it saved Metallica, one of the biggest bands in metal.
Yeah, and then he's had an amazing career.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
But then you talk about how, like, you guys were kind of the big four, right? Like,
you
were in there. Anthrax was in there. Did you ever have that experience, like when you're in Anthrax and it's blowing the fuck up, nobody's blowing up like Metallica's blowing up. Are you guys looking at Metallica like, fuck, if only we could be Metallica level?
I mean, yeah, but in a way of like, you're just so happy for your bros because I was there the day they showed up in New York City in a U-Haul truck with Dave. He was still in the band because we had the same manager. And he was like, do you mind going down to the music building, which was this shitty squat of a building in Jamaica, Queens, in South Jamaica, where bands could pay a couple hundred bucks and you'd have a 24/7 room, you know, monthly. And so you could put all your gear in there and, like, literally have a place to crash when you needed to. And that's where they were coming, and that's where they were going to live as well. It's not like they had a hotel or something to come into. They were living in a squat in South Jamaica. And he's like, you mind going down there and greeting them? And I was the guy, me and Danny Lilker, the original bass player in Anthrax, we're like there to meet them, and they come like rolling in after driving a U-Haul across the country. And it's like they load their gear into their room and they set up and they're like, okay, where are we staying? I'm like, Johnny,
you're here?
I'm like, Johnny didn't tell you, our manager, like he didn't tell you. Maybe you ought to call Johnny.
That's like, great. He's like, oh, my stuff's dropped off. So can't wait to get a hot shower and a bed.
Yeah, they quickly found out they were living at the music building. And it was like, oh, my God. Like, well, we have a fridge in our room. We gave them our refrigerator. We gave them our toaster oven. Like, you know, just anything to help these. And, you know, we were fast friends from that point on. So, yeah, and by the late 80s, like, in like 88, 89, when they were already headlining arenas, mm-hmm. like this is pre-Black Album on Justice for All, where they were already big enough to headline arenas themselves, but it hadn't gotten to that Black Album stadium level yet. Even at that point, we were always like thinking like we're only 6 months behind Metallica.
Oh, yeah. Like, yeah, that's a fucking hard thing to do in this in any business.
Same thing happens in comedy, right?
In comedy, you watch people and you're like, all right, like Nate Bargatze is one of my best friends, and he's gotten like, you know, he did an hour special, and then a year later, I did an hour special, and then like, but then like he sold a pilot, and I'm like, all right, buddy.
Pilot time for the Danny Boy.
And they go, no.
We were doing great at that point. 87, 88, we were selling 7,000 tickets,
that's
you know?
That's awesome. Yeah.
Like, we were doing great. No complaints. Our gold, like, 2-3 gold albums already. But then, you know, you see Metallica get to, all right, now they're selling out arenas instead of theaters, and they've got a platinum record. And because our manager back then always used to say that. He goes, you guys are only 6 months behind. And it was kind of like that. That's how it was for years from, like, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88. And then 89 rolls around, and they start selling arenas, and it's like, all right, 6 months is up. Like,
arenas take a year.
Like, we did an arena in New York, and we did one in L.A., but what about the rest of the, like, we haven't quite, and then they hit Black Album, and boom, like, it's like, it's not even like 60 years behind. It's just not happening.
Right, it's
not going to happen.
It's a different strategy.
It happens with one band, like, and that's it. Us, Megadeth, Slayer, we're all good. I've had great. I'm here 36 years later, still talking about my band.
Yeah.
We still get to do whatever we want. There's no complaints. But only one band was going to go to those, you know, those heights.
What do you think of? Because you guys have always been progressive in Anthrax about hip hop music, musically, like, you know, doing stuff with artists that are outside your genre, especially at a time when that wasn't really happening. What do you think of how much hip hop is now kind of taking from metal in terms of even in the imagery, like you see it in their shirts, like they're wearing shirts. Some of them are just wearing Anthrax or metal t-shirts, but
right.
The ones that aren't are like, you know, Kanye's whole Yeezus line was all metal looking shirts, and Justin Bieber's line was all metal stuff. Like, what do you think of the culture?
Are they trying to sell less? Is it
trust me, I've been there. It doesn't say, yeah,
you know what I mean? It's like, and I'm half kidding, you know, because I'm not trying to downplay metal or what we do, but you know, guys on that level, you know, who are stadium acts and things like that, it's like, you don't, I don't know. If maybe there's a coolness factor to it because it's more underground,
mm-hmm.
like I've seen that. You see a picture of an actor or some TV personality wearing like a black metal t-shirt, and I'm like, there's no way that person's into Gorgoroth. Like, it's just not happening.
Right.
Like, so it's got to be some type of coolness factor thing, or there is some kind of cred. I don't know.
I saw like an 11-year-old kid in a Nirvana shirt.
They sell Nirvana shirts at H&M.
That's the thing. Yeah. Like, do you guys even know? It's just weird. Yeah, because that's what it is. It's like,
it's
a reference.
But some people could genuinely be in the metal too. I mean, I see a lot of people wearing Iron Maiden shirts. I'm sure some of those people are actually into Iron Maiden. Why wouldn't they be? They're awesome.
Yeah. So we've only got a couple minutes, and the book, by the way, is called "Access All Areas: Stories from a Hard Rock Life." It's available now. Tonight you're going to be at Book Review in Long Island in conversations with Scott Ian, and that's at 7 p.m. Eastern. And then tomorrow you're back to California, and you'll be doing a signing at Book Soup in West Hollywood. At 6 p.m. Pacific.
Book Soup on Sunset, one of my favorite stores. I love that place.
Real quick, before we got it cut off, Nico over there,
yes,
he's our intern, he's a virgin, but he's going to the AVNs with a porn star for 5 days, and they're sharing a hotel room. Dude, in your experience.
Is this something that, like, was set up because of the...
Well, he met the porn star here.
Right.
But, like, then he took it upon himself to get it all done by himself.
Well, that's great.
Yeah, it's amazing. He's a great dude.
Scott just laughed like Robert Duvall in Apocalypse Now, where he's like, he's like, it's war. And he's like, nah, no, buddy, trust me.
Where does he need to set his expectations? You're a person who's been in all situations. Like, is he a guy? Because right now he's going like, no, I'm getting laid while I'm out there. Is he going to fuck himself over if his expectations are that high? Or... Well, it seems like you've got it all worked out.
Yeah, I mean, right? Unless, who's paying for the room?
That's where it gets tricky, because he's...
So far, she is.
Well, that's good, because I was going to say, like, maybe if you were paying for the room, then she's just there because she's got a free room, and she needed a... I don't know, and... But, yeah, I don't know. I will say this. I had one experience last year. Last year. I DJ'd at the Hard... Is it at the Hard Rock?
Yeah.
Yeah, I DJ'd at the Hard Rock a couple of times out in their center bar. They did this thing where they had dudes from bands. Like, they had Tom Morello. They had all Flavor Flav. They had all kinds of different people coming in on, like, Saturday nights and play whatever you want. So I'd, like, literally be the center bar at the Hard Rock, like, cranking Slayer.
Yeah.
And it was a blast. And but one of the times I did it, the AVNs were going on, and it was right after the actual award show thing. So all that crowd kind of spills out into the center bar at the Hard Rock. And I got to say, it was a very weird crowd. And it's not so much that I have anything against the porn industry or people who work in it, but it was more the creepy dudes hanging around on the periphery.
The Nikos of the world.
Dude, I've seen this guy right here. Weirdest, creepiest people.
A lot of tucked in t-shirts.
Like lurkers. Like, it was weird. It was really weird. And then that night, actually, I start doing my thing, and a lot of people are there that are into metal, and I'm playing metal music, and some dude walks over who works for the Hard Rock and says, the GM is here, and he wants you to play mashups. I'm like, I don't even know what that means.
What?
You guys hire me to play metal. And they're like, well, it's no good. He's at a table full of women, and they want to dance. I said, well, you got the wrong DJ.
Yeah.
Unless they want to dance to Pantera, it's not going to happen. Yeah. And they actually cut me off.
What?
Wow.
Yeah.
You should have played Walk
They literally shut me down. And usually I do it for 2 hours. This is like 20 minutes into my thing. And I looked at the guy that I work with there, this other manager. He's like, this is way over my head. And I said, look, I don't give a shit if they shut me down as long as I'm getting paid. I came to Vegas. He goes, don't worry, you're getting paid. And I said, fine with me, 20 minutes, like, I'm done. But they literally shut me down, plugged in an iPod that then went on to play, like, EDM. I went back to my room, and I got paid the same for 20 minutes.
That's a pretty good day. Well, listen. That's a great day of work.